With me today, I've got Piet van Sail from Senior Chef, a very interesting company that I'm very excited for my entire audience to get to know. It's all about school fundraising, but I'm here with the owner of the company, and I'd really like Piet to just share with us what the company is about and what you guys do.
Yeah, thanks, Francois. Maybe a bit of history. I started the company 19 years ago in 2002. I was a teacher, and at that stage, there was, fundraisers are always schools needing some funds to fill onto their budgets. And came up with the concept of trying to find products that are used every day in each home. And so the whole concept came then, and we decided on using spices and other house products, kitchen products, as products in this school fundraiser. The basic concept of the fundraiser is that each kid gets an order form and a brochure, takes it home, and then the parents, he actually gets 5 order forms and 1 brochure, and then the parents order what they want on the list. Grandmother, grandfather would order something, maybe the next door neighbor, basically ordering, and then the school gets a certain percentage, which is 25% of the turnover. As funds for them to use whatever they had set as a target, maybe for a school bus, for new computers in the computer room. That is the basic concept.
Piet, tell me a bit more about the products that's on offer.
Okay, so obviously the initial concept was that we wanted products that are used every day in each home, so that this is a transaction where you buy a product that you in any case would have bought, and you would report it at your local store. So currently the Inopalmen involvement with this is fantastic for us to say. In the 19 years, they've been on our list for 18 years, and with a wide variety of products, well-known, quality well-known to everybody. And obviously launching new products from our supplier side, also obviously comes onto the list first most of the time. Then we've got a lot of the demographics these days of schools means that you can't have only products for higher income market. You have a wide variety of kids in each class, so we literally have ranges of products like the Senior Chef spice range, where if you want to buy just the curry or steak and chops seasoning, that obviously is on there. So there's quite a big range of spices on there in the Senior Chef range, which is at this stage exclusive to schools, without all the nonsense like MSG and preservatives that is in there. Then we've got some fantastic suppliers, like Montague Dried Fruits, that supplies healthy snacks. Same with Safari. That have also got quite a wide range of products you can actually put into lunch boxes. Lunchbox products like biltong, in 25 gram sachets from Cape Deli, has been on there for many years. Droewors, anything that can go into a lunchbox. But I mean, the project itself is not about filling up lunch boxes.
No. My lunchbox would have been filled with biltong and droewors. You had me at droewors.
So even from Willow Creek's olive oil, and I'm leaving out Carb Smart, is a new range that I'd say for the people that's into banting. I'm trying to think, there's so many products, and they differ each year. We add on some suppliers, we try and freshen it up each year, but those are more or less the products. We've got a nice range of Walker Bay spices that is well known for their bry salts, and other products as well. That would be on the list. And as I said, every year we've even got plastic bags, black bags, Ziploc bags, products like that. So it is really products used every day.
And it's a diverse range of products. It's not only like spices. It's like literally, and as it sounds to me, it's like kitchen supplies, stuff that you typically want to use in and around the kitchen.
Even stuff like microwave popcorn. So there's really something for everybody. Somebody wants to buy for the house, that is an essential, it's on there. If there's something that is a luxury, like biltong or something like that, it's on there.
The point being, it's easier for the child to market that, because you have this, and you know what? You're anyway going to buy these products. Yeah. Don't go to your large supply store, the grocery store. If you're going to buy it anyway, can buy it through us, benefit your child and benefit the school and benefit the community.
Yes.
What I wanted to ask you, that 25% that the school get, what generally happens to that 25%? You've now been working with so many schools.
Yeah.
What do they do with the 25% that they get?
Yeah, well, I think the need is so diverse on what schools use it for.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we've had schools that specifically say they want to build a swimming pool.
Yeah.
Or they want to, you know, get more teachers and be able to pay more teachers. It actually goes that far to pay salaries. So to have better education, less children in classes, add on to that, so for the appointment of extra teachers.
So it's like SGB appointments of teachers filling,
yes,
up that budget.
Yeah. Yeah, so that, I mean, anything that from equipment needed in your computer rooms to school buses, it's all part of the budget of a school, whatever they want to use it
for. So they determine when we need X amount of money, we're going to use that, and...
Yeah, I always suggest to schools, you know, putting a goal out there for a child to say, we all want a new swimming pool at the school, you know, or AstroTurf,
yeah,
or something like that. Then we're all working in the same direction, and at the end of the day, when you go back, maybe many years back from it, you can say, with that year's fundraiser of Senior Chef, we have built this AstroTurf, for instance, or the swimming pool.
And it's to benefit of everyone. It's not just necessarily a monetary benefit. It's actually increasing the school facilities or having the school,
yeah,
run. So it's up to the school to decide what they use the money for. But in essence, if you have the whole school participating in the fundraising, you want to do something with the money that benefits everybody in the school.
Yes, definitely. And I mean, we even break it down then when, like rugby touring groups or netball or hockey, going overseas, and the only 30 pupils, we would allow them to do this fundraiser just with the 30 people to raise money. So it's not only for the whole school, it sometimes happens just with a class group, but we prefer if a whole school, you know, does the project. It just makes a bit more sense.
Now, the two of us have had many conversations about your specific product and services, but what I'm interested in is the stories of the schools that really like are go-getters with this project. Can you like mention an example that comes to mind of a school that really benefited from this, or that stood out from the rest of the schools that you typically work with?
Well, unfortunately, it would be the school where my little daughter's going to.
Which no nepotism here, no.
Which is Large Stellenbosch.
Okay.
They've managed to do over 600,000 Rand with this project. And the nice thing about this, so obviously they get 25% of them, and they got a prize for being the top school in that section. So just achieving over 600,000 Rand in a two-week campaign is amazing. But I think what people don't know is what is the stories behind this, how was this done, and obviously there's involvement from parents. They are quite equipped, organizers that run this project, you know, that would either be part of the school's team or the parents. But stories behind that would be that there were two brothers in the school that actually decided that they want to sell a whole lot of the healthy stuff, and they... One of them sold, I think, something like 160,000 Rand on his own.
One learner?
One learner sold 160,000 Rand on his own, and his brother more or less did the same the next year, I think. And what they did with that, and it's wonderful that the youth of today is actually thinking about people that are less fortunate than they are.
Yeah.
So what they did is they sold this to friends of their parents under the banner of they're going to give it away to charity. So they only sold the Montague dried fruit and Safari dried fruit products and the biltong and the droewors, which is healthy snacks. And then they sold this, and afterwards they went to all the disadvantaged schools and they handed out boxes of droewors and biltong and nuts.
So an example of giving back to the community and not just keeping it for yourself.
So adding up to the total of over 600,000, there's small inside stories of amazing stories of these kids that actually got involved in such.
And we need to hear all of these stories. I mean, I think that there's a lot of inspiration that comes from an initiative like this.
Most definitely, yeah.
No, wonderful.
So also from an entrepreneurial point of view, you know, kids get involved, learn certain skills with this project. And we've been very privileged and lucky to have accumulated quite a few astute suppliers in the country, like in Palman from Palman Foods.
Yeah.
Mrs. Palman herself is an ex-teacher, like myself, and she's very passionate about entrepreneurship. Many more, Montague Dried Food Safari, Willow Creek, quite a few suppliers that are well known out there to South Africans.
Okay. So Pete, schools need to do fundraising, and it's almost sad that schools need to try and find funds from external sources. In your experience, what are the typical type of fundraising activities that schools typically do?
Well, obviously, as an ex-teacher, the raffle being sold by kids, you know, was obviously the most popular ways of doing fundraising. Mm-hmm. Golf days, I think, would be another one. Wine auctions. So I think those are quite common out there. I think when it comes to raffles, you don't get something in your hand. It's odds.
Yeah, it's like
either for you or against you. So it's a gambling game. And with us, the nice thing is you're getting a product. You're paying a price for a product that you would have bought in store in any case, and you're getting a great product back.
And I love that about the product, the whole fact that it's a grocery product. It's something that you're going to use in your house anyway.
Yes.
So, and you've got a child in school, for instance, or you know of a child in a school, and you can assist your community, you can assist the school in raising funds, but then at the same time, you're actually getting value because you're going to use the product.
Yes, no, most definitely. And I think what also is important, you're getting a product, but you're not limited to just the school's parents and the immediate families surrounding that, and this, or maybe in a small town that you're staying, where you've actually got limited budgets of each home. You can, fax stuff through these days. You can email stuff through these days. So if my parents stay in Claymont, for instance, we're in Stellenbosch, we can do it over the phone or over the internet, and even get orders in, so that one town is not limited to the amount of money available in that specific town.
Yeah, because if you look back traditionally, a child will have their form and they walk door to door, which is not safe really anymore.
Yeah.
Depends on the community, but they can't really do that. And then generally in that model, you like stuck with the geographical space that you're in, and you don't have exposure to other markets.
Yeah.
But with social media, and I know from your website, you also now have an online platform where you can order these products from.
Yeah, obviously you've got to move with time.
Yeah.
So a lot of schools have asked that for us. So we listen to what the schools have requested. So we spend quite a bit of money on having an online ordering system whereby you can pay by credit card. It's linked through Google Sheets, onto the school's computers.
Yeah.
Each school gets a specific code that the parent just fill in, that goes to that school's accumulation of their funds. But there are some schools that still say, you know, obviously internet is not freely available to everybody, and they don't want to do payments that, they don't want to do orders that way. And for that, we've got the Excel sheet whereby they can still, you know, count up all the orders.
So there's a nice mixed methodology of still sticking with the old traditional way in which we do the orders, but then also teaching children and the parents as times move on to move like onto online retail.
Yes.
But tell me, what's the benefit to the school and to the child? Because now we are basically becoming salesmen for the products that you have.
Yeah.
But there of course needs to be a fundraising or some benefit to the school and the child.
Yeah. Look, so for me, there's clearly two parts to this. The first one is a school gets 25% of the turnover. So if a school sells in the 2-week period that this project runs, sells 200,000 rand, they get 50,000 rand out of this. So that is quite clear.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, my heart is there for entrepreneurship. And I think when you give a child the opportunity to take these forms to his parents, you start learning skills and actually getting the guts to ask somebody else as well, even if it's just your grandmother or your granddad, you know, asking them to buy something from you. And I think this all builds up to somebody becoming an entrepreneur. You certainly learn a lot of skills through this project, working with money, getting the confidence of doing a sales transaction, because that's in essence what this really is. It's not a raffle that you're selling, it's a transaction that's taking place, and the child is part of this transaction. So it might be this child's first transaction that actually ever happens.
And that could spark an interest with the child, which could lead to them actually becoming an entrepreneur.
Most definitely. Look, I mean, I've told the story many times about my little daughter, Carla, that when she did the project for the first time at her school, she obviously came back with that, and she didn't have the confidence even to ask, you know, her grandmom and granddad. So I said, you know, you love them, obviously, so there's nothing wrong with asking them. Ask them. Obviously, they supported her, and the one thing led to the other. A few weeks later, after the project, she was so fired up for entrepreneurship. She organized her own entrepreneur day in Welgevonden Estate where we stay in Stellenbosch. She literally organized her friends to bake cakes, make some things, and there was odd 5 or 6 kids sitting in the park there. We advertised it on Facebook and people were coming there to buy stuff. And she had organized that, obviously with the help of her mother as well. But
And children need that type of support. I mean, you're not going to expect the child just to run a day like that and on their own.
Yes.
But the initiative came from her.
Yeah.
That little spark was there and she went like, you know what, I can, let's do this in the estate.
Yeah.
But what I love about this is she incorporated and included her friends.
Yeah.
Because she can't just have a market day just with her own stall selling her own things. And that starts igniting a spark maybe in her friends. And currently the education system is not focused on entrepreneurship.
Yeah.
Very few subjects really place a focus on that. We don't have a lot of focus on mathematical literacy, financial literacy itself. And these are nice, innovative ways and authentic ways that we can teach children the skills of entrepreneurship.
Yeah. Yeah, most definitely. I think most probably my background as a teacher is obviously still where a lot of my heart lies.
Yeah.
And I think the opportunity with spending time even with your kid, you know, a lot of schools tell us they'd rather ask the parents to pay another 100 rand to their school fees. And that's missing the point because through this project, you actually get the chance to win. If there's success, you can explain, you know, and be happy with your kid for that. If you get a negative answer, somebody doesn't want to buy from you, or you have a bad experience, to also handle that. So it actually gives you the opportunity as well. And parents have to take that decision as well to say, in the days that we live in with social media and everything that really can become such a big part of a kid's life, this is opportunity where you can actually start a process where entrepreneurship can be done and where you can spend time with your child learning them lessons through this project even.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think we're missing the point by saying that, you know what, if we want more funds, we can just increase the school fees. I mean, that's not feasible for everybody in our country. We know the economic status of many of our parents can't even afford the general school fees. Now we want to add on levies and stuff like that. So that makes it difficult. But as you correctly said, the focus here shouldn't be on the money raised. That's the benefit to the school engaging in a project like this. The point being the skill of entrepreneurship. Or even if it's just the skill of sales, like you mentioned, that's so important. Our kids don't get exposed to that.
Yes, no, definitely. And I mean, the project itself, it's not a lot of admin work to the school. And I think that's maybe something that I need to emphasize as well, is that we supply brochures, very good looking, good quality color brochures, order forms, you know, the online ordering platform, the Excel platform, you know, advice from our office side. There's this really personal relationship between our company and schools.
It's not like you just dump everything on the school and say, please school, now it's your baby from here on. We'll come and collect our 75% and everything's happy.
Yeah, Davetu is our general manager. He handles all the schools on a day-to-day basis and, you know, going the extra mile and making sure that everyone understands. If they haven't received the product, for instance, you know, he makes sure that everybody receives what they have ordered. And clearly works out good that way.
Wonderful. Pete, tell us if a teacher wants to get involved, or a principal wants to start doing this project at their school, where do they get hold of you? How do they sign up?
Yeah, obviously these days people go to the website first, which is www.senorchef.co.za. It's spelled www.senor, and then chef, C-H-E-F.
Or one word.
Yeah, .co.za. Or they can contact us at the office in Stellenbosch, which is 021-8833-826.
Wonderful. What we'll do is we'll put all of that information in the description and in the links and the comments everywhere on social media. Whoever is seeing this or hearing this, they'll be able to get through and get you.
And obviously the email addresses of me and David will also be on the internet that they can contact.
So it's as simple as that. Just pop onto the website, they can make contact with you and then David will take the process further.
Yes, most definitely.
I love the project that you guys are doing. I really buy into the entrepreneurial side of it. Our kids need a lot more exposure to that. But thank you for taking the time to chat to us about your product.
Thanks, Francois. I appreciate the opportunity. Thanks very much.